So, Andreas, thanks again for your time. And I know you are a busy executive working between Europe and Asia. So we are really privileged that you could find time for us. So, Andreas, can you share with us your career journey, a little bit background of yourself, and what are the different pieces in your career that when you made the decision, what was prompting those decisions, what learnings you have had? I think it'll be good for the audience who have seen your background, but maybe hearing from you will really give the color to about yourself and things that they can learn from.
Well, first of all, thank you so much, Anant, and your team for having me here. It is such a pleasure also to see some former colleagues and friends and all of you. I guess we share the passion for emerging markets, and which is really a special place to operate in. Yeah, as you say, my journey up to now and ongoing has been quite long, with many unexpected twists and turns. As education-wise and from an early career perspective, what I did up to now was not entirely mapped out. My background originally is in physics, then I went into banking, then I got an MBA, later wrote a PhD in health economics on rare diseases. But really, it's the start with Novartis and my first assignment to Asia after jobs in strategy and M&A at a global level back 20 years ago that really changed everything. My first move to Singapore was for a one-year international assignment, which then transformed into more than 20 years working with emerging markets. The opportunities, the challenges, the cultural diversity, and the huge variance across all the healthcare systems, the standards of care, the maturity of the markets, the growth dynamics, the profitabilities, and the risks, all of these across multiple therapeutic areas are immensely enriching, refreshing, rewarding. And I would say, from a business and personal perspective, addicting. The best part is that given the huge unmet medical need and the hurdles that you have to overcome across all the levels, from disease awareness, diagnosis, market access, distribution, affordability, compliance, treatment adherence, everything. And the more we in the healthcare industry, we are successful, the more actually we are helping patients to be healthier, live longer and happier, while also contributing to the economy of these markets. And I would summarize by saying working for successful pharma and medical devices and service companies in the healthcare space creates jobs, but also enables more people to work and have an empowered life. And if I look back on this journey, I must say, what bigger reward can you have than this? What better meaning can you give to your professional life and aspirations? And this is a quick introduction why we're having this dialogue.
Thanks, Andreas. So as you mentioned, with the doing multiple things, when you came to Asia, you spent like 20 years and being a leader in different kind of in different settings. So what advice would you have, like someone who's coming to be a new leader in terms of building his or her own journey in the emerging markets, who's coming there new, not necessarily being born and brought up and groomed there? What kind of learnings you would have for someone who's coming into emerging markets and kind of being exposed to all the complexities as you've outlined?
Well, if I may summarize, I see a few points that you really need as what we used to call key success factors. I would say the first one is you need to be competent and confident in your function, because very often in emerging markets, one needs to build, expand, experiment in uncharted waters. And you better know what you're doing from a functional perspective, because everything is being tested and challenged. Saying that, one also needs to be mentally agile. The situations are ambiguous, highly fluid and dynamic, and you have some, very often you have very little data, and you need to learn to listen, observe, not judge, just absorb, learn to really understand how it works, what are the gaps, and where you can have an impact. But then you need also to be culturally respectful and humble. when people like me from an international setting, we move into emerging markets or into other countries, we are there to build bridges. We need to care, we need to dig in, we need to share the pain with the team, but also celebrate together the success. And that means we have this participative, very respectful, embracing function that we need to fulfill. Mm-hmm. You need to have integrity. Very often when you operate across a culture and systems, there are different standards and you need to respect what you find. There is no way to go into emerging markets with kind of an imperialistic attitude. It doesn't work. On the other hand, you need to stand up for your values and behaviors, and especially the ones of the company you represent, because you cannot have an inconsistent approach to business and how to operate with your stakeholders there. Also, you need to be focused, you need to set priorities, because emerging markets are so vast, so diverse, so complicated, it's very easy to sink a lot of energy and funds with relatively little impact if you don't prioritize and do the right things. Lastly, I would say you need to have tenacity. My personal learning was the first couple of years in emerging markets, I was barely considered as a tourist. It takes a while to earn the trust and the credibility. So if one wants to commit to emerging markets, it's for a long-term game. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. So talking about the tenacity and kind of being there and being immersed in the culture, but a lot depends, as you know, about what is the commitment of the company to the emerging markets, because from the global side, there are always multiple regions, as US, Europe, Japan, and all. And I believe one of the tasks that you would have been doing is how to sell the region to global, why one would invest in these markets versus going further in the US or in another country. So what was the trick? How were you able to get the funding there, unless there was like a lot of people already behind? Now things have changed in the last few years, but over the years, how have you been able to build that story for companies to be excited about? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, it is key to build the trust, both from the global and the region organization and your local teams. If you work in these markets, you need both to succeed. It's very simple. And that means you also need to kind of educate both ways, honestly, openly, especially to manage expectations. Look, there are some companies, some leaders in headquarters that say, we need to go to China, there is 1.4 billion people. Well, 20 years ago, we already knew that China, in reality, we were looking about some 300 million people in the big cities and about 800 million farmers. So you already need to define what is really the market that is accessible and viable for us, just to manage expectations on what is a realistic growth, what are realistic profits, what is the cost of doing business, but also what are the risks. Then there is also the part of education towards global regarding compliance and the cultural challenges that you face. But also the other way around, when you build a local organization, in many ways, you need to bring close to them that working for a multinational, you have other guidelines, other SOPs, and other cultural norms that you need to fulfill also. Because, for example, if you're listed in the US, there are some expectations that the company also satisfies. That means, the positions I had, and probably many of you also hold in emerging markets, it's really, again, building bridges, and that you can only go so far by preparing PowerPoint presentations and sending emails. My not so secret, what I applied here, I really pushed to invite global and regional leaders to visit the countries, to see for themselves how it looks like, how it works, and how difficult and how challenging it is, but also where the opportunities are. And vice versa, I always put special effort to send good talents from the emerging markets into global headquarters or into Western market on rotations to learn how it is on the other side. And this cross-fertilization really goes a long way. And then on a more tactical or technical basis, continuously review the targets, set the milestones, and always discuss what assumptions are we making. Remember, we don't have a lot of information in many of these markets, so you make assumptions. That means we always keep track also on the risks, the opportunities, and already defined mitigating measures. So it's a continuing, evolving journey that you go to operate between global and local execution.
So Andreas, and talking about the data, like, you know, decision making in these markets, and from one of the questions is around what is emerging market is like the countries where the funding is not sufficient to cover for the population. There is patchy funding, the infrastructure is not developed, there is huge population, but, you know, the things are not as clear or a little bit ambiguous. And the countries are growing, the countries are expanding, but still there is no clear pathway in which one could understand how to go about it. So for the data issue, where you have been in, you know, you've been in different countries in Asia, for example, you know, China may not be emerging now. It's still considered a kind of part emerging and part not. But in generally for situations where you didn't have sufficient data, especially coming and working in Germany before and worked, you know, in the US with the US market. How did were you making decisions on investing without data?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you need to operate across anything that is in any form and way available. Mm-hmm. For sure, you start to buy everything that is, every intel, every data that is kind of available in the market, like the classical IMS, now IQVIA, and there are many other sources as well. It's important that you understand the source, the approximations that are being made. So for example, even IMS data are approximation based on samples and the sources of error, and then continuously validate across the sources where you have overlaps to see, to make it more and more accurate. I also strongly believe in primary market research, using agencies, using your own teams. Remember, all these companies, they have sales forces, marketing team, and key account managers that go out, enforcing the culture of the company, this curiosity to ask questions and to share back all of this intelligence that you have from your own team. And sometimes you really don't find the data and you have some creative commercial ideas, then my advice is to run pilots in a relatively contained pilot that you compare if your approach works in terms of education, marketing, sales, anything, versus an area of the country where you're not doing it, and see if there is an impact and if it's a profitable impact at all. In some of the markets, I introduced also BI system, business intelligence systems, where with the teams, we consolidated all the data sources, and specifically we compare and we show the quantitative reporting with easy to read charts, combining the commercial impact with the investment, but also the activities that we perform, including also the competitors. Mm-hmm. So we could even narrow down on an individual, on a rep, on an account level, if it was a good business that we were performing or if there was room for improvement. Mm-hmm. Also on top, because most of the pharmaceutical and or medical device companies are in a very similar situation, and there is a cross-fertilization of talent. I believe also in good competitive intelligence. So building a good competitive intelligence function, a team that reaches out and collects all of this information, interprets it, and builds it into your own planning. Mm-hmm. But last but not least, you can only go so far by looking at spreadsheets and PowerPoints and PDF reports. My recommendation is spend time in the market yourself. Don't sit behind the desk. Talk to all the stakeholders. I personally would spend somewhere between 40 to 60% of my time in the field, in the market, with the different stakeholders, just engaging in conversation, trying to understand and learn and to build it on in and to fill in the gaps.
Right, right. So I'm a company, let's say in the US, and I've been operating in the US and Europe. and a little bit in Japan, I've heard, but all the other, I call it frontier markets or international markets. And I want to get in there, I have to make a start. So what kind of commercial models do you think would be needed to be considered, and how you approach the countries where different from some of the bigger companies that already have the presence, but these are the companies, they have great products, and the patients really need access to these technologies or products. But how to make a start for a company which has never been into LATAM, Middle East, Asia, Eastern Europe, all these non-traditional markets, which are non-traditional for many companies now that we know, but still there are several out there. So what would you say, how to start with the, what kind of commercial model will work or should work, and what advice you give to them?
Yeah, I wish there was an easy answer. I mean, it really depends. It depends on the type of product you have. It depends on the market you're looking at. It depends on your appetite for risk, on the funding you have available, on all of these factors. There are some markets like classical China. It's still very much a share of voice driven. That means you still need large field forces for your products. We know some of the big multinationals that have way more than 10,000 people just to do the selling. Some other markets, it's more concentrated. For example, if you operate on rare diseases and you have just a few centers of excellence, you just need a few specialists, and they pretty much can cover the whole market because there is not much else out there. In some cases, you engage distributors and you can move from, and we close deal across the whole range from a pure logistic model to a full agency model, and then some hybrid solution in between, where some of the functions you want to keep close to your heart, like medical, marketing, scientific affairs, while the selling you give to distribution. In some markets, you need to build up very strong tendering functions because you simply need to win the tenders, and then it's like either you're in or you're out, right? You need some experts for that part. And in somewhere it's so difficult, so complicated, where you have large hospitals that drive your sales. Again, I'm looking at China, but I'm also looking at India to some extent. You have multiple stakeholders, even within the same institution, that you need to take care of to drive the consumption, the prescription of your drugs. So, for example, while in Germany, if I have a regulatory approval, marketing authorization, and reimbursement, which are relatively easy to obtain, I just need to go to the individual doctors and do medical information to enable them to prescribe the drug to the right patients. In China, in a hospital, I will need to make sure that I have the hospital listing. I need to work with the scientific committee, with the hospital president, with the purchasing department, with the department head, with the prescribing doctor, and with the nurse. And it's not the same people. Depending on who you're talking to, you have different specialists that have to work. And we had to develop strategy, customer interface strategies, where you have a constant, an orchestrated effort across everybody to come in to build the sales and to maintain the sales across the whole organization. And that makes it so fascinating and complicated at the same time. But then again, you go to Southeast Asia, you have again a completely different model. So it's really tailored on the case-by-case situation.
So I'm just on the multi-level stakeholder engagement, as you talked about the example in China. One could say that that is something which is there in any market, in US or in Germany or five EU, and you know, more developed countries in Asia, if you say Australia and others. So what would be the difference from what you would do in a Germany where you worked, and in China where also you worked? You talked about multi-level, you know, all the different stakeholders to be aligned with. What differences one should consider?
Well, as an example, I mentioned a few of the stakeholders in some of these large hospitals. I might have pretty much all the stars aligned. My product is listed. The purchasing department has it in the list. The doctors know about the product and they could prescribe it. And the nurse also knows how to administer it if it's a hospital product. But if I forget, for example, to make sure that the hospital pharmacist also places the order and has the drug in stock, then nothing goes, right? And while in a Western market where you don't have dominantly hospital business, but individual doctors do the treatment of the patients, the doctor basically just writes the prescription on a sheet of paper or electronically, and then the patient goes to the pharmacy and finds the drug there. And if the pharmacy doesn't have the drug, they can order it and it will be there in 3 hours. Mm-hmm. Or he walks a few hundred meters and then he goes to another pharmacy where they have it, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And that's it. So it's relatively easy once you've done your homework at a country level. While in China, you really need to chase account by account and make sure that everything is aligned and on board. Mm-hmm.
So in other words, what you are saying is that some of the things you can, even if it's a hospital in a more developed setting, certain things, certain processes work, and you don't have to really look at controlling each aspect and be really making sure. But in the example that you gave, where all the things are ticked, but you still have to make sure that you are double checking that the things are working, just not make assumptions. Is that fair to say?
Correct. And that is why with the unit systems such as BI system, business intelligence systems, in some cases that go down at account level, mm-hmm. To see that everything is on track, because every account is so key, so relevant, and so impactful for the whole presence and for the whole business.
So the other thing, Andreas, is when we say quote unquote emerging markets, you know, people say, what is emerging market? But one main definition or characterization is a lot of people, a lot of patients, and at different levels of the income pyramid. And not all are being covered. So traditionally, and even now, as we see, many of the companies are looking at the top of the pyramid. You know, how can we serve? Because they are familiar business models there. But if you really look at building a market, building the business for the future, as we talk about, you know, in the boardrooms, there's always excitement about, you know, a million millionaires in a country like India or in Brazil and all those countries. How would you think to really build something for the longer term, to really take advantage of the big population, big set of patients? Is there a way in which we balance it out? We just go in there, wait for, you know, losing the money in the beginning and then see something will come in the future, or more pragmatic approach? What have you seen when you really want to look at, or you say, look, this is on paper a big number of patients, but in reality, the market is smaller in terms of reachable. Some things, if you can share on your views on this kind of conundrum. Mm-hmm. Say.
Yeah, well, it really starts with understanding the market and getting information and define what is really the accessible market. In pretty much all of the countries across Asia Pacific or across emerging markets, you need to make a decision on that. For example, I remember in India we were looking at everybody was saying, well, India has more than 1 billion people. We were talking about 20 years ago, and then we look, but what is really accessible market? Because most of it was really self-pay at that time for big chunks of the market. And then somebody came up with the idea to say, well, we look more or less at how many TV antennas are there or cable TV or something like that. Because if somebody doesn't have a TV, probably they can also not afford a Western drug. Right? So you're using some proxies, some comparables just to help you understand what is really the target segment, to which doctors will they go? And which pharmacy will they visit? For example, in China, there is also traditional Chinese medicine. And then you need to understand a patient for which kind of a condition, for which kind of symptoms, he would go to the traditional Chinese medicine doctor and get that kind of a treatment. And where and how do they get access to a doctor who prescribes Western medicine. And then you have to find those, you have to identify them and inform them about your drug and how it works. And sometimes they even make a combination of the two. So it's really about coming in with somebody that has a global perspective, an international perspective, who understands how the products work, for whom they are, and how they should be used. And then with the local team to come from the other side and to bring it together, and then to decide which segment of the market can I go to, and how do I access the patient, how do I access the doctors, how do I ensure the distribution, right? And then finally, my products will be used. And that's where even now, China is still segmented by tiers, by class of hospitals, and so on. And that's where you set priorities. And priorities that then translate into where to invest, where do you send the people, and even how you package the marketing, the promotional, the educational material to drive your sales.
Thanks, Andres. So I'm just looking at a couple of questions that came in the meanwhile in chat. So from Shuen, it's around, have you encountered any consistent themes of pushback during primary research? And how do you overcome it? Overcome these kind of challenges and pushback during primary research in these markets?
No, not really, because depend pushback by whom, external or internal? Externally, not much, because you have companies that are well established and they do this for a living. They build up networks of healthcare professionals that they can engage with events where you do focus groups and you drill to better understand the condition, how they're treating the condition, how to diagnose and all of that. Internally, well, here and there you could hear there were some leaders that said, I don't believe in market research. We just go out and we just do it because it's all confusing and complicated and probably not a good investment of money. If I have to choose, should I spend $500,000 to do market research, or should I rather hire 4 additional sales reps to make sales, and then maybe they make this other decision? But besides that, I never really saw significant pushback. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. The other question is around the high cost of therapies for rare diseases, gene therapies are coming up. How do you see these progressing in emerging markets?
That is definitely a big challenge. As I worked myself on rare diseases and aiming to establish orphan drugs in some of these markets. So there's huge diversity here. There are some markets where there is funding, there is commitment by healthcare authorities to fund. There are pathways to get market access and reimbursement. And then there are others where there is very little or almost nothing. And then there are some other Southeast Asia markets where you even see private funding for some treatments. Now, the real challenge now is, as a company, you have the drug, you know there are the patients, and you try to help them. And some models that you can do is you do some named patient access programs where you provide the drug for compassionate use to overcome. And these are models that have been applied already over many, many years. Everybody knows the famous Novartis Gleevec example in India, where the idea was nobody should suffer or even die because they cannot afford or they cannot get access to the drug. And that is was the ownership and the duty of the pharmaceutical company to make the drug accessible. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, when you talk about orphan drugs, the challenge even is even more upstream, that the patients are not aware of the condition, the doctors are not aware of the condition, and you need even to introduce awareness and diagnostics just to identify the patient, to even start a treatment for an orphan drug. And that also costs significant amount of money because you really have a fundamental build-up, including also building up centers of excellence where some of these rare diseases can be treated. So for example, we're looking at a country like Thailand. For some of the rare conditions, you might have one or two centers of excellence, maybe Bangkok, and then maybe one more city where you have a doctor who actually knows how to identify and how to diagnose and treat the patient. But then it's built up, including having speaker tours, inviting to conferences, even working together with patient association and patient advocacy group that also exert a pressure to the healthcare authorities and to the payers mm-hmm. to actually fund the treatment of these drugs. Mm-hmm. But it's still a very, very long journey. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it feels we're just starting to begin to do this.
Right. And then, you know, switching gears a little bit, we talk about the opportunity, how to go about exploring or exploiting the opportunity, providing access to the patients for the treatments. What about competition? You know, when we have been there, how do you look at competition in these markets? Is it like you don't even think about it, or there is competition, or how have you managed to navigate through these questions that always come in a traditional business plan or marketing plan? So can you say a little bit about competition in emerging markets?
Yes, well, just to put it on the table, I think about competition the whole time. Some old colleague and friend of mine said that the ultimate measure of success is market share. That means winning over your competitors. But besides that, in emerging markets, I really see fundamentally two types of competition. There are the other multinationals, and then there are the local companies. So with the other multinationals, pretty much all of them have a very similar approach, although there are some differences, for example, between the US-based and Europe-based companies or Japan-based companies that you can see on how they set the priorities, on how they operate, and also the implication on the talents that they hire and engage. Some companies from the multinationals, some are top-line focused. That means if there is an issue, a challenge, they invest even more to achieve the top line with the philosophy that if the top line is good, then the profitability will also be good eventually. While some other are bottom-line focused because they look at earnings per quarter. And if there is an issue, they cut costs just to protect the earnings. And that immediately changes the way you decide or you make some investment decisions, long-term versus short-term. Some are fast, really risk-taking. They jump in, they invest, they say, let's test it. If it works, it's going to blow us away. And if it doesn't, we will do something else. And some are very conservative and followers in their approach. Mm-hmm. And then I must say, some are very compliant and some are a little bit less compliant in the way they operate in the market. So there is some diversity, but overall you see the multinationals are definitely competing with one another. Mm-hmm. The local companies, on the other hand, very often they have different product portfolios. They don't have this originator products or patent protected products. Most of them are really generics. And sometimes you see also differences in the quality of the product. They definitely have a different pricing, a different commercial approach. Multinationals, they all have to subscribe, for example, to FCPA and the Anti-Bribery Act and so on. Local companies have a different approach to business. Very often they used to be state-owned companies with very strong local networks and mutual relationships and dependencies that also contribute to drive the sales. And they have also different connections. So I know that in the past, in some markets, we even defined the market for ourselves to be just a multinational market. We would not even consider the local company as part of our market or the accessible market. So consciously saying we operate only here, we are not going to compete against the local companies, even though we both might operate, for example, on hypertension and diabetes. But if a patient, if a doctor prescribes a local product, a local drug, unlikely he will give to the same patient suddenly a Western medicine that costs a lot more. Mm-hmm. And there are some consideration also about the doctor's mindset, but also the affordability of the patient. And I spoke to doctors, they said, yes, I know that your drug is better, but nobody will pay for it for this mm-hmm. patient and he cannot afford it. So I have to do this. So you could as well say, okay, this is not part of my market, right? Although in the long term, ideally, you should be looking at the whole market. But to boil it down, I think if you go there in emerging markets and you need to build something up based on the competition, you have to take a three-step approach. First, define the market and segment the market, the patient categories, the doctor categories, the accounts, even the cities that you decide to be present and where not. Then second, you need to define what do you want to be? Who do you want to be? Are you going to play the premium segment, in the middle segment, or do you chase everybody? How do you position the company and your products? Against who will you really compete? And then a third, you need to set up the whole business with the budget, the competencies that you need, the sizing, the presence, and the positioning, and you decide what kind of talents you need to go where, to do what, and what kind of costs you incur. And these three steps, they sound like a lot, but actually it's only 10% of the success. 90% of the success is actually executing it.
So, and then execution-wise, you also talked about people. And I remember in our previous discussion, you have been pretty passionate about managing talent and people, the importance of talent. So how have you, what has been your approach for managing talents, for getting the most from the people out there, mix of local, non-local, or in general, how you groom talents in non-traditional markets?
Mm-hmm. It helps to have a good mix of talent, in the sense local talents, definitely you need very capable, best in class local talent to be successful in the market. But it also helps, and not only in emerging markets, but overall internationally, to have always an influx and outflux of talents from different markets to share best practices, to bring new ideas on how to operate. Regarding some of these emerging markets, they're really hyper-competitive and there's such a war for talent and everybody's trying to poach from other companies. And we were looking at turnover rates of 25-30% in some of these markets, while at the same time, you want to almost double every year. So the speed limit of growth in some of these markets is simply driven by the talent. It's not by that you don't have the funding, and it's not that the commercial opportunity isn't there. It's just that you need to preserve the quality and the sustainability of the company. In China, at some point, we were hiring 10 to 15 people a day, which meant we had to interview 60 to 80 people a day. So you have to set up a process, an operation to do just that. And then you need to do the onboarding and the training and the targeting, target setting, and send them out into the market to sell. And to attract the best talent in the market, which makes a huge difference, I'm going to talk a bit more about that, you need to offer a full employee value proposition, which is, it's not about the money. You need to offer the whole package. Of course, it comes with the title, it comes with the money, the package, but even more so, it comes with career opportunities, the opportunity maybe to go rotation and an international assignment or to get training. We used to have a budget, an average budget per employee of more than $3,000 per year just for training, right? And these are things that people talk about and they know and makes one company more attractive than the other. Ideally, if you run a really good business, a good company, the best talent will come to you because they see this is a great company, gives me opportunity to succeed, to grow, to make good money, and to give me a bright future. Vice versa, if you're not that company, you have high turnover rate and people will leave. So that is the key part. Now, speaking about the importance of talent, one of the reasons why I really cared a lot about this business intelligence system, the BI system, was with the data, you could really see the Pareto principle, where some 20%, which is the 20% of the people, the effort, the investment, whatever, generates 80% of the returns. In the emerging markets, in many ways, I saw it even more skewed, where 10% of the team was generating 80%, sometimes even 90% of the results. And you really want to know who these 10% are and keep them close and make them prosper and give them everything they need. And you want to hire more of those, because this will make the difference to growing 50% or growing only 20% per year. And that means you even want to do some internal market research. How do they operate? How do they work? What drives them? What makes them different? Because you want to elevate the whole organization, the whole team, to come close to this 10% that delivers so much. Right. And that means, again, focus, prioritize, understand.
Right, right, understand. So meanwhile, another question that came up, you talked about our competitors have been sometimes only the MNCs, and we have to target where we should go to and so on. So this question from Salman is, are the traditional MNCs really cut out and have the required mindset to operate successfully outside the traditional markets, like outside US, Western Europe, Japan? Have you seen this mindset changing, or still there's a lot to do there and it'll continue to be an uphill battle? What do you see from your side?
Well, what I see that the big ones, the one that everybody talks about, the top 10, top 20, they really went into these emerging markets somewhere in, some already in the 60s, 70s, but the big rush came before the Asian crisis, so in the 80s, and then 90s, 2000s was really a good buildup. And they are established, they understand, they refine the strategy, everything else. But there is still a large part of pharmaceutical or medical device or service companies that are medium-sized or relatively young, biotechs, for example, that yet have no presence in Asia or in emerging markets in general, and they need to build it up. And they also don't have the understanding yet, not the experience. And for them, there are different models. They can partner with companies and there are very well established companies in Asia that they will do everything from you, from a full agency model all the way to just simple tasks. Or you partner with other multinationals and you do licensing agreements where you pay royalties for large geographies. I think there is no company in the world that owns a good asset, which is a good molecule, a good treatment, or a good device that says we can ignore emerging markets or so. Actually, I hear just the opposite. I keep hearing statements like, we cannot afford to fail in China, right? There's still a big rush over there, because keep in mind, you know, in countries like Western Europe, Germany, France, UK, every patient who has a condition and needs a treatment actually pretty much gets it, right? So it's very much a zero-sum game. You can work as hard as possible, and then maybe you gain a 0.1% market share or something like that compared to your competitors. Well, in the emerging markets, there is room to grow for everybody. So it's like the place where you generate growth and profits, and it's a long-term game. And this is where everybody wants to show how successful they are. And by the way, the patients are there. They're waiting for the treatment. So you really contribute there as well.
Perfect. So we can continue talking, and I'm looking at the time as well. And I think a couple of people have left. I was thinking, people can open their cameras, we can take a quick snapshot, and we have the last few minutes for any additional questions as well. Thanks, Andreas. I'm also looking at the time. We are kind of almost there. So in the interest of time, I'm just kind of a few things. If I kind of the recording will be available, but if I pick up a few things that you mentioned today for people to take home with, a couple of things jump out. You talked about the three-pronged approach, which is about define, you know, what do you mean by the said emerging market from your point of view? What is a segment and, you know, what are the different segments out there? Second thing, you talk about what you want to be. So unless you know what you want to be, it is difficult to move to the next step, which you talked about, operational excellence, execution, which is key in terms of getting the things going and really having a successful business model. And the other thing which also jumped out to me was you talk about the talent, you know, not only the mix of talents, but also how much effort it needs to get the right talents in, and the Pareto principle around, so not only 20, no, not just 20, sometimes even 10%, accounting to 80 to 90% of the business. So it's so important to have an eye of the right talent and then working to make sure that they are staying with you. As the growth is happening and the turnover you mentioned around 25% in some instances that you've seen. And of course, there is a talk and some of the questions that we went through around having the right mindset, having companies looking at the non-traditional markets in terms of growth coming in versus moving away from these markets to more profitable and more traditional markets. So the recording will be available. Thanks again, Andreas, for your time. And as always, if anyone has any question, please feel free to write separately. I will try to make sure that Andreas can be able to address them offline as well. And that's all for today.